To be continued.
To be continued.
Hi, Gary, there?
I'm here.
Okay, run the volume up.
All right, I'm just going to get the volume up on the set here.
Can we turn this way?
There's all the guys.
No.
I don't think they can hear us yet.
Not yet. In a minute.
Okay, we can hear you, Gary.
You can hear me now.
Yes.
What a scruffy-looking group of hams I see on my Skype.
That's us.
Tell you what, I would like to do this as an episode of Ham Radio Now. Oh, you turned out the lights. Now I can't see you. So what I want to do this as an episode of Ham Radio Now, if you guys don't mind. You'll be on my TV show as I'm doing you a TV show. So this is how the show starts. Ham Radio Now, episode 148. What was it, Jeff?
148.
The Great South Bay Amateur Radio Club. That's what these guys look like. And tonight, I am, sadly for them, I am their program. And I have a special treat for you guys. Sitting right here in the Ham Radio Now studio is my buddy Jeff, AC4ZO. Say hi to everybody, Jeff.
Hi, everybody. Happy to be here.
Oh, you're getting the clap.
That's much more than it deserves.
you're getting the golf clap.
Oh, no.
So normally when I'm doing a program, I'm interviewing people. I'm talking to them about things and asking them things. And I'm not perfectly well suited for giving a program, except I had an idea. I will interview you. This is a radio club. But I'll do that in a minute. But first, I will talk about some stuff here. And I'll stick Jeff here on to help me out, because I'm pretty inept.
Yeah, I feel right at home. I worked in their town for a few weeks.
You did?
A number of years ago, yeah. Yep.
Doing what?
Putting in a telephone switch. Well, more than a few years ago. It was 1985.
Yeah, they had telephones in 1985?
Color TVs, they ran on kerosene, but they had color TVs and telephones, automatic telephones, yeah.
You guys had telephones back in 1985? You're not as far out on Long Island as I thought you were. They're not even patronizing us, Jeff. They're just sitting there.
They're waiting for you to do something entertaining.
Something entertaining. Yeah, it's never going to happen. So Ham Radio Now is an online television program. How many people there have seen Ham Radio Now? Stick up your hands. Yeah, nobody. How?
That hands went up.
They may be frozen.
That
image is frozen.
Is your picture frozen? No wonder I'm getting no reaction. It's just
very cold. Can you refresh them?
Yeah, okay. So since I can't see your hands go up.
I could hear them.
You heard the hands
yeah,
go up?
Yeah.
Okay, Jeff heard your hands go up. So evidently some people have. And I probably more people have watched Ham Nation. Tell you what, since I can't see you because you're totally froze, applaud if you've watched Ham Nation. Oh, there we go.
Okay, yeah, okay, that's good.
All right, so that's not too
And
bad.
Now, how about if they've watched Ham Radio Now?
Oh, applaud if you've heard Ham Radio Now. I'm going to put in the applause track here now.
That's great.
It's not too bad. All right. So I don't really need to tell you what this is, but what I thought I would do is a quick review of all the stuff. I was going to say crap, but I won't. All the stuff that you can see on online on about ham radio. And so this is, if I got the right thing up.
I'm seeing Ham Radio Now.
Okay,
yeah,
so that's me.
Your page.
And this is you guys. We're going to get back to you guys in a minute. There's Ham Nation.
Okay.
People have asked me to give a kind of review of what you can watch online. So everybody knows who Ham Nation is. They're the big 800-pound gorilla. I heard something crash back there. Do you know what it was?
Yeah, I dropped a tool.
Oh.
Whoops.
You're such a tool.
I know it.
I gave Jeff a screwdriver so that he would feel comfortable, and he dropped it. He's trying to pick it up without moving the microphone. So back here, everybody knows about Ham Nation. If you know about Ham Nation, you probably know about AmateurLogic.tv, because George W5JDX is the moving force behind Amateur Logic, and he's also the guy that does Smoke and Solder on Ham Nation. And those are the two 800-pound gorillas in the ham radio video world. Mm-hmm. They get thousands of views. This program can be seen. It can be seen by billions. You know, technically, it's on YouTube, but is seen somewhere between 1,000 and 3,000 to 4,000, depending on if I put something about Flex on there, it goes up to 6,000. Otherwise, it's 3,000 to 4,000. Let's see, what else have I got here? You probably all have heard about Newsline. Does your repeater, any of your repeaters carry Newsline?
Yeah, we carry it.
Okay. And you know that you can listen to them directly on the web if you want, if you don't want to wait for the repeater to do it. And they even do a podcast. I'll show you my podcast listener in a minute. ARRL's got a lot of video up there, although I haven't seen anything really lately. The last thing I see on their YouTube channel is this ARRL at 100. And Jeff, do you remember when we reviewed it?
Yes.
Yeah,
I do.
You kind of liked it. I was a little disappointed. You know, it's the thing that disappointed me about ARRL at 100 was that this was the 100th anniversary of video celebrating the 100th anniversary of the league. And while they put a lot into it, they tossed the kitchen sink into it, they didn't do a really good job. It was and it was a professional video company that did it for them, but it was an amateur-ish production.
Well, the pitfalls they fell into are very common pitfalls in amateur radio programming.
Such as?
It's the intention is to aim it at non-hams, but only hams would enjoy it. lots and lots of jargon and concepts that are not given any context. Lots of details with no context.
Yeah. So. Well, I actually think that they were aiming at hams because they were celebrating 100 years of ARRL.
Oh, okay.
So I think they are aiming at hams, which means the jargon is not so bad.
Yeah.
But they had people reading off of cue cards or teleprompters.
I'm getting really old now, so I don't remember very well, but it's coming back to me quickly. Yeah. I do remember that lots of times what they were talking about, what was showing on the screen, didn't support what they were talking about at all. It seems strange. The pictures.
Yeah, it could be. Could be. I don't remember the program that well because it's been a long time. But
that's about all I remember.
Yeah, what they were doing, the people were kind of stiff and wooden and reading, and they had them facing off camera, but not talking to an interviewer. They were just kind of facing, doing a weird off camera thing. So, and it was also disjointed. They would do a little bit of history and a little bit of today and a little bit of history, a little bit of today. I wish that as a premier program from our big organization, they would have put in a little bit, cross that line into really well done from, but not quite. And my friend Alan Pitts was the writer, W1AGP, and I haven't talked to him since, and I didn't see him out of Dayton. He's probably mad at me for that review.
Well, they have budget constraints.
Yeah.
Like everybody that does video.
Yep. Well, anyway, there is quite a bit of video out there from ARRL, and I'm hoping to see more. This is a podcast that seems to have gone into pod fade, and I really ought to give the fellow a call at KB4HQA. He did talk show type stuff and a little bit of field production stuff for a long time, but he hasn't had anything online since last August. This guy, on the other hand, is very prolific. K7AGE, and he has just joined the Ham Nation crew to do a lot of videos for Ham Nation. Maybe George got worn out. He ran out of ideas.
Maybe.
So they got Randy to come on there and do the things that you like.
Yeah, right.
Not the things that I do, the things you like.
Right.
Which is encapsulated in the phrase
Hams doing ham stuff?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Hams doing ham stuff.
Yeah, you like to
not shoot. Hams talking about doing ham stuff.
Which is what you like to do.
Well, it's
because you can do a lot of it quick.
Yeah, it's not that all I like to do. It's just that's with the constraints of time and budget, to do a field recorded piece and edit it all together and stuff, I'd be doing one a month, not one or two a week. So I do some of that, just not as much as either one of us would like. Look who you have.
I got the bear.
Yeah. I heard some folks in the background say the bear. Clearly they've been watching.
Yeah. He's been milling about since before the show started.
Yeah. Yeah, he always shows up. He's our Walmart
greeter.
He got
close enough to grab that time.
Okay, so let's see who else is out there. Have you guys ever listened to the ICQ podcast? Clap if you've heard ICQ podcast. Ooh, it's quiet.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. What do we have to look forward to when we hear
ICQ it? Podcast is a couple of Brits, although they have a couple of Americans. It's a roundtable discussion. They kind of read the news. They pick up stuff from Newsline and from ARL Audio News and a few other sources. And they'll read it and comment on it a little bit and kind
more
of banter back and forth. Then they'll usually do a special. This is just an audio one. It's not a video.
Okay.
They'll usually have a special segment where they go into something a little bit deeper. And some personable guys just kind of bantering. But so far, none of the people that I've talked about so far do what I call a broadcast level professional program. They're all amateurs, and that's not a problem. There's no problem with being amateurs in doing a program like this because we're not necessarily looking for true broadcast professionals.
Lots of us care a lot more about the content than the production quality.
Yeah. What I look for is people that will be personable, casual, not stiff.
Yeah, just interesting to listen to people.
Yeah, which is probably my biggest problem with Ham Nation, is that those guys seem to have no charisma between them. They're all of their conversations seem kind of wooden, and they're not scripted, but they seem like they're doing what they think they ought to be doing, and not what would be really natural in terms of interaction between them. Mm. Not all the time, and not exclusively, but Bob Heil is Mr. Rogers.
Okay, I'm not going to get involved in this, so carry on.
Gordon West is Gordon West. Gordon West is just the world's most lovable goofball ham.
Won't you be my neighbor?
We're getting it back there. I wish I could see your picture move. And George is warming up, but he's been doing amateur logic for so long that I sort of think of George as being thumbtacked to the wall behind him. He's just ramrod straight all the time. But like I said, he's warming up a little bit. I did a show with George and Tommy at Huntsville. Some of you may have seen that, and I warmed them up more than they do on their own show. I know what they need on their show.
You?
Yeah, they need
you
me.
You used to be on that show.
No, I used to be on Ham Nation. But
Ham Nation.
They've used a couple of bits and pieces of me on Amateur Logic, but I've never been over there in person. So let's see what else we got here. The Rain Report is probably the granddaddy of everything. Hap Holly was doing the Rain Report before there was podcasting. I think he sent them out on cassette tapes.
Oh, my goodness.
I think he sent them out on Morse instructographs. So he's still going. In fact, every time I do an interview with somebody, I go over to Rain Report, and he's already talked to him. And I listen to his conversations, and he asks better questions
than you do.
Well, sometimes he does some interesting, strange things though, because he's interviewed me a couple of times too. He will take all of the spaces out, close things up, so that. If normally I'd be speaking at a pace somewhat like this, if it were to be played back on the Rain Report, I'd be talking like this, and I would be jumpy, and I would be very fast.
Wow.
Not sped up, but just all the spaces taken out.
Right.
Because he doesn't want to waste your time. Me? I got no problem wasting your time. It's all about wasting your time.
Yeah, we've seen that for 144 episodes now.
147 episodes.
Well, three are more worthwhile.
Oh, were those the three you were on?
They're the three I watched.
And here's a dirty little secret of Ham Radio Now.
Oh,
Jeff
no.
is my frequent co-host.
Mm-hmm.
What episode are you up to?
Well, I don't watch them in order, but I've seen four or five of your shows. Yeah, I don't watch your shows.
It keeps him fresh.
I watch the ones where hams are doing something. I love the fox hunting in Umstead Park.
You know, it's sad. That program, now that I put it online, it's sitting at about 1,700. 10,000 hams should have watched that by now. It's sad. I think the problem is not enough people know it's there, because it's just a fun show.
I think you're right.
That and the field day.
And that's a great one, too.
Yeah. Just they should be in the 10, 20,000 range. Yep. I have no idea why they're not. You guys aren't doing your job. You're not telling people about the programs. That's your job, tell people about the programs. This Week in Amateur Radio, these folks seem to have done a pod fade. Pod fade is when you've done a podcast
for a while.
Yeah, for a good long time, dozens of episodes, and then you just disappear.
Well,
and looking at their website, there's no word about that they've gone away. It just says returning soon. And they got Facebook page and other stuff, and I don't see anything there.
Yeah, they probably figured out how much money they can make doing it and had to get a real job.
Yes, the answer to that is not much money. This has not podfetted. This is the Practical Amateur Radio Podcast. This is another audio only. And Jerry dedicates this primarily to new hams, people who might want to be hams, people who want to learn about something. Each show is pretty much on a specific topic, and he will just go through it from his own knowledge. He doesn't typically have guests on, although sometimes he does. He asked me to promote his podcast.
Oh.
So I'm doing that now, Jerry.
Good. How long have they been on?
Well, they've been on for years and years.
How many?
I don't know. Does it say right here?
Yeah, upper left corner.
Upper left. Oh, the seventh season. You say that as if I should have been paying attention.
I'm just messing with you.
So he's been on longer than I have. I can see somebody moving in the background there, and yeah, it didn't last long. It's somebody took a quick jump. He'll talk about some specific aspect. The only problem I have is that he's reading his script, and it takes a real super professional to read something as if they're saying it.
Yeah, but if he's aimed at new hams are trying to get as much information as they can. And
yeah,
if it's online, like that, that's just wonderful. And again, you care about the professional production and all of that, but most hams, well, some of us care,
See this group of people back here that's frozen and very fuzzy?
Yeah.
They don't care.
No, I don't either. Yeah. I don't either. Being read to is fine.
Yep.
It's what they're reading I care about.
Right. And his content is superb. Yeah.
It might be more fun, if it was more conversational.
Yeah. When he asked me to promote his podcast, I sent him back email, which either never got or never got around to answering, and boy, do I know about that. I mean, I get way more email than I can answer, even with this dumb little show.
I had to start sending you more.
Forget it. I said, Jerry, how about this? Let's do a show where you do a, what is it called? Practical Amateur Radio Podcast on Ham Radio Now. You do your show, and I'll kind of be in the background, and I'll ask you questions and snipe at you. Maybe that was the problem. Didn't want to be sniped at. But he didn't answer. So, Jerry, if you're catching this, let's do a show together sometime. You do your show on my show. And we'll both synergize that way. So,
that's a mighty big... Remember, I'm just a technician. That's a mighty big word.
Synergize?
Yeah.
You're a technician because I busted you back to it for not turning your radio on.
Right. But I still don't know what synergize means.
Yeah, it means works together. The sum is greater than the whole is greater than the sum of its parts.
Oh, okay.
You guys have to explain this stuff to Jeff. So let's see. These guys. It looks like they're going to come back. The Youth and Amateur Radio Podcast. Yeah, these guys. The last one they did was last August, and then I just played this new one. And is that it? No, that's. Let me play this here. I thought there was something wrong with my system when I started playing it, because their music is all distorted. But when the voice comes on, it's understandable.
That music, that distortion is intentional.
Hey.
Probably. So.
This is Jacob Keogh, KD0NBX from YARP, the Youth and Amateur Radio Podcast. Here at YARP, we've kind of been on a little hiatus. However, we'll have new content out for you as soon as we're done with some hosting changes.
Okay, so they're going to work on some new stuff.
Okay, good.
I mean, it's great to hear young people get involved in doing stuff like this. The first couple of podcasts, they set out to do some difficult things. And a lot of people who do a ham show or start doing a ham show fall into this trap, and that is to explain everything there is to know about ham radio in a short show or even a long show. You can't do that. We're way too big. It's like, you know, fire hose at you. So if you ever want to do a show, don't do a, here's everything you want to know about ham radio in a show. What else have we got here? Been there. Solder smoke. I think that, they're still around. Here's the thing that confused me was that this date here was, for the last show they said was May 2013, but it wasn't. It was, let's go to their blog and listen.
All right. This is, what's today's date? It's the 26th of May, 2014.
Okay. So he did
3 days ago.
he did what I do all the time, which is screw up the website with wrong dates and stuff.
All right.
Okay, next.
So they're healthy.
Linux in the Ham Shack is very specialized. Since I don't do Linux, I've never listened to them. And now, ladies and gentlemen, drum roll please, the TX Factor. Okay, you guys, applaud if you've watched the TX Factor.
Oh, that's a shame.
Awfully darn quiet over there. Okay, the TX Factor is your professional, seriously professional ham radio show.
It is a good one.
Yep, they're just in episode 3, and they've done a couple of other little bitty bits and things. Again, it's another British import. It's a highly produced field recorded, which means they take their cameras, multiple cameras out into the field.
Yeah.
Or they do a lot of museums. And they record their interviews, and but not just faces, people talking about stuff. They shoot the stuff that they're talking about. As Jeff says,
Ham's doing ham stuff. You know, and I'm ashamed to tell you, I've watched a third of their episodes, but only about 4 or 5% of yours.
See, they're good. I've watched all of. Actually, I'm only about halfway through their episode 3. I kind of ran out of time.
I didn't know there was a second and third one, or I would have watched that by now too.
Okay, so yeah, and they're only on YouTube.
That's one to watch. If you're only going to watch one,
if you're only going to watch another one,
that would be a good one.
Yeah. So, like I say, really professional. Yeah. They're all broadcast professionals, and they know how to do this stuff. And again, if I've got any criticism about it, which is not really a criticism, it's more just a comment, is that they come across like just about anybody who's doing a magazine show on broadcast television. You don't learn very much about the guys. They're not stiff and formal, and it doesn't sound like they're reading a script all the time, but you also don't know them.
So, yeah, maybe once they get 8 or 10 episodes, they'll do one.
Yeah, and they've said they'll come on my show, and then we'll find out
Be good.
Who they really are.
That would be good.
They've just been so busy. And they've carved out...
I would watch that episode.
It's just hams talking about doing hams talking about doing ham stuff. You'd never watch that episode.
I would watch it.
They have carved out for themselves a huge job. Now they've got a bigger crew than I do. Here's a shot of my crew. And Cliff and W4FT. Cliff helps out a lot too. In fact, you blew me off at Dayton. You just wanted to do ham stuff.
I didn't. I had a great time at Dayton, but I didn't work with Ham Radio Now this year. No. I did work a day though. All day Saturday in a testing session.
Yeah, doing VE.
Yeah.
VE's doing VE stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So good for you. But you had been sneaking away from the show as long as I would let you. The longest leash I would give you, which is the edge of our FRS radios. And you'd go do that. Yeah. So was it good?
Oh, yes. I had a great time, especially Friday. Friday was my big day because Saturday was a work day. And, you know, Sunday, the flea market's all but over.
Yeah. So you spent it all in the flea market except for when it was hailing.
On Friday. Oh, the hail was Saturday.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So you had a good buy anything?
No, I did see something interesting, something I'd been looking for years, an RCA microphone, the 77DX, and there was one in the flea market.
But you didn't buy it?
No, he wanted $1,000 and wouldn't come off from it. He turned down $800. It was in good condition, not excellent condition. That little metal band, you know, that goes over the top of it had a ding in it. But it's still just a thrill to see one again.
Is that the round one that looks like a capsule?
Yeah.
Or is that the diamondish one?
No, the diamondish one is the RCA Velocity. And there was also a Junior Velocity, which was smaller. I thought you had a Junior Velocity.
No.
I don't see it here.
No.
Okay.
No. Yeah. This was my purchase.
Tie wraps.
A bag of reopenable tie wraps. And the problem with reopenable tie wraps is they charge you per open.
They're more expensive.
You get a bill at the end of the year. If you've opened it 10 times, they charge you 10 times.
Did you go to Mendelssohn's?
That was from Mendelssohn's, Yeah, they're hard to find, but they're ever so useful.
You know, one thing I learned while I was there, that Mendelssohn's is open during Hamvention every day, including
their
Saturday.
Their store, not the...
Their store downtown. Yeah, they have a big store downtown, 4 floors, I think it is.
Never been there. But I understand it's like the old Radio Row in New York, and Chicago, where I grew up, had sort of a Radio Row kind of thing.
Yep.
All right. So that's, let's see, we did the TX Factor, and that's kind of the end of that.
Yeah.
So now I'm going to go back to this thing here. You guys recognize this, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So I need a spokesman, and unfortunately, you're going to be just kind of a radio show to tell me just a little bit about your club. How many folks are in your club?
137.
That's a pretty good size radio club.
Yeah, that is good.
And you guys are out on Long Island.
Yes.
And you got repeaters and stuff like that. Can anybody turn on a handy talkie on your D-Star repeater? Are you in range of the D-Star repeater where you are now?
Yes, we are, but anyone have a D-Star?
I'm surprised.
It's just like our club.
I like putting people on the spot. So is there a D-Star handy talkie turned on there yet?
Yes.
Okay. I'll turn my microphone down here. Well,
I didn't hear you come through.
Yeah, I don't hear it. I'm connected to your repeater, at least I think I am. But that was a failure. There's one thing about your radio club that I wanted to ask about, and I don't know if it'll be anybody that can answer this question. But this is part of my interviewing you guys. Is that what I want? Yeah, that's what I want. This is where you guys are, out in central Long Island. But all these little towers that are on the map here are part of something called a mesh network. And is your mesh network expert in the house?
No, he's not.
No.
He's not here tonight.
So, do I understand correctly that your mesh network expert is the mesh network expert, and he's the only guy who knows what anything about this is?
Not quite.
Good.
There's a couple guys there who have a clue, or is nobody who has a clue there?
I'm not here tonight.
Well, what do you want to know about it?
What the heck is it?
Oh, it's a network. Using, and I'm trying to remember the Linksys routers, but they're reprogrammed to become ham routers. The 2.4 gig band is a ham band, so we actually have a private network using these Linksys routers. There's a certain model, and I don't recall what it is.
WRT 54 gig.
Again?
WRT54G.
Okay, a WRT54G router. And we reprogrammed them and set up a whole network. And as you know, it is a ham band, so we can't use it as a ham network. It's still under construction. We're still putting the system together.
So what can you do with it?
Connect computers together. You can send video over the system. Anything you can do with a regular router.
And so somebody using a computer on one end can talk to somebody using a computer on the other end with voice or video or text or send files and stuff?
Right, correct.
And as I look at the map, these things seem pretty far apart for 2.4 gig. Can they all talk to each other? Or how does that work?
Well, we're in the process of putting it together. So we keep adding nodes as quickly as we can. At different stations and key locations like a hospital up on a tower. We try to find good locations, much as you would do with a repeater, except that they have to be fairly close together.
You need a high-gain yagging antenna line.
Okay, so you put an antenna up on the roof as opposed to a typical router antenna, which is either inside or... maybe a little rubber ducky kind of thing sitting on the back, which gives you no range at all.
You can go in the indoor antenna. Some people have their nodes there, but you only get about a block or so range on that. Better range is outdoor, either omnidirectional or directional Yagi. Big advantage of the mesh is it's low cost to set up the nodes. They usually run 12 volts, so you can run them off a battery in an emergency. You can put them in your car and have a mobile node, and it gives you another form of communication in the event of a grid down situation or a partial grid down, like when we had Hurricane Sandy last year. If we had a mesh node network up at that time, it certainly would have helped in communication.
Okay, so for now, this is an experiment for you.
Yes.
What do you think, Jeff?
I think that's pretty interesting.
Would that be something you'd actually try if they had one around here?
You know, the router that I use every day at my house, the WRT54G, the same router. I've got one and been using it for years.
Yeah. Yep. I'm sorry, go ahead.
It has to be there's a particular version of the router, for certain firmware version, to match up with the updated software of it, not all versions of it. Also, more interestingly, lately, there's a type of router called the Ubiquitous, also known as the Bullet router. It's a six single things about the size of like a soda can with the antenna right on top. That's designed to go outside. It's weatherproof. A lot of people have been experimenting with those. Those work very well, too. You can just put them like on your tower, on your chimney, on your TV mast. It doesn't matter. Hopefully, we get enough nodes up along with backup power. We'll have a really good network going. And other ham operators around the country have set up some really good networks. When you also combine them with directional antennas, you can get some really good distance for just an operation or even for just emergency.
Do you rely on the internet to make some of the connection and fill in where direct radio to radio isn't going to make it, or do you try to stay away from the internet?
We're trying to make this its own separate network from the internet. You can connect a router to the internet for it, but then you also get issues of different kinds of transmission that you're allowed to get across the internet that you may not be able to do on ham stages, like a commercial, for example, might come across accidentally, and you're not supposed to do that. But then also, if the grid is down, if you have infrastructure issues, this should be able to operate independently of the internet. That's the key point of it.
Okay, I got it. Jeff, that sounds pretty cool.
That's a great project. Has anybody looked at the spectral purity from the router, how the transmission looks coming out of it?
We have done point-to-point tests with cameras and voice over internet. We're still experimenting, testing with multiple hops to see how well that will do.
Yeah, I meant the spectral purity, you know, how much undesired signal comes out of that router, being that it's, you know, intended for low power and within a house. Sometimes, you know, sometimes there's surprises when you look at things like that on the spectrum analyzer. You know, I think the guys with the with the DV dongle had some issues.
Oh, yeah, the DV dongle is very dirty. You don't want to run that into an amplifier.
Right.
Yeah, we haven't looked at it on the spectrum analyzer. There are amplifiers available, 2 and 4 watt amplifiers. We have not hooked them up to that, and I think probably looking at it on a spectrum analyzer first would be prudent.
Yeah, I did one of the Tapper shows that I did was some guys up in the Seattle area. They were up at 5 gig, and they weren't doing a mesh network. They were doing like old repeater big iron, but with wideband data systems on 5 gig or 5.9 gig.
Mm-hmm.
And I made an sort of a off the cuff inadvertent comment that they're doing something that hams, no other hams are doing. And I got email from the mesh network guys that say, oh no, we're doing that and more. We've got wideband stuff, but they're doing it differently. They're not on big towers. They're not doing the big iron. Just right. A couple of spots. They're placing it all over the place. And I guess if you can fill in enough of these, you've got really good connectivity. I need to do a mesh networking show.
Yeah.
So that would be cool.
Yeah.
Well, guys, I think it's about 9 o'clock here on the East Coast. Probably just about time to wrap up the Euro Radio Club meeting, I would guess. Am I correct?
We didn't get to see their donuts and snacks, see how they compare to ours. We're too late.
they're all gone. So, who out there in your club remembers how Ham Radio Now gets signed off? I will start. I'm Gary Pierce. Well, first of all, I got to point back there to Arvin and mention the website hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy the programs, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There's a little shot of what you look like. And if you enjoy the program, if you get anything out of it, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's picture, and make a contribution. I expect that I'll get something from everybody in this picture right now. I've got a photo recognition going on, you guys, so I know who you are. So I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and...
This is Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
And do you guys know your part now? Some of you know. Go ahead. Belt it out. Come on. You know how to do it.
Yeah, we don't watch the show.
See, they don't.
Well, he has to remind me how it goes every time, too.
Yes. You guys say over and out. Anytime.
This was fun.
That was really sad.